Hi, I'm Amanda Cox, the referee manager for the WPL, and today I'm going to take you through some focus areas and referee priorities for our upcoming season. So, our referee priorities exist at the areas of the breakdown, scrum, lineout maul, space, and foul play. And at each of these focus areas, we've identified referee priorities. Today's module is just going to focus on the breakdown, arguably the hardest area of rugby to referee. At the breakdown, our key priorities are going to be a clear release by the tackler and the tackle assist player, the tackler rolling away, any extra movement by the ball carrier that may impact arriving players, and all involved players supporting their weight. The breakdown is one of the toughest things for any referee to officiate, and our philosophy comes down to looking at the balance of strength, so who has the support or who was at the breakdown first, the quality of the contest, were the arrivals legal, does the defender able to support their weight and lift the ball, and then the quality of the clean out. Does anything interfere with the clean out? Is it a legal clean out? So we're going to use a blend of these ideas to officiate the breakdown. When we think about the breakdown, the main thing we want is quick ball, and that means the ball is available to be played by the team in possession. So obviously the tackler and the tackle assist would like to slow the ball, so these two roles are our target and our main objective, making sure the defense is squeaky clean. We're going to be watching the ball carrier for any extra movement, which impacts ball availability, and we want to reward the balance of strength and good technique by the jackler. And finally, the last piece in the puzzle is arriving players. So each of these things gets looked at in progression as we move through the breakdown, and as you probably know, there's about 150 breakdowns per match for us, so the referees are making a lot of decisions in a very fast period of time. Quick ball means probably 3 seconds, all of these things need to be looked at. So it's a big job. When we referee the breakdown, the first person we need to attend to is the tackler. The tackler must release the ball carrier and the ball and then move away from the tackle. In this first clip, we see Gold land on the wrong side of the tackle, number three, but she moves to the side quickly and doesn't impact ball of delivery. In this next clip, we're going to see Blue 1 end up on the wrong side of the tackle. He does slow ball availability, and he impacts the white team's arrival to the breakdown and their ability to ruck. They shouldn't have to play over him, and this should be a PK against Blue 1 for not rolling. Here, in this clip, both the red tacklers end up on the wrong side. They're caught in, they can't move out, but the white player cannot set the ball backwards, and the white arriving players cannot play over the red tacklers. This should be a penalty kick against red for not rolling away. And here in this final clip, the tackler rolls into the arriving players instead of to the side. This impacts how blue comes into the breakdown, with the number nine coming in the side instead of going over top of the green tackler. So even though we'll see the green poachers are on their feet and in a good position to get the ball, we cannot reward them because blue cannot compete fairly with the green tackler in the way. So here, the first infringement is the green tackler not rolling away. Oftentimes, if you have a match with a high number of side entry penalties, it is a good idea to check and make sure you aren't missing the tackler not rolling away. The next person we have to look closely at in the breakdown is the tackle assist player. This is any player who helps bring the tackler to the ground but stays on their feet. Most recently, we are seeing the poacher attach to the ball carrier too soon, making them a tackle assist player and obligating a release. In this first example, there is a timing issue by the white poacher. They needed to release before playing the ball because they lashed before the blue player was completely to ground. This should be a penalty for white tackle assist not releasing. Here, several green defenders are going to make the tackle. Green 20 never fully releases the ball carrier before playing the ball. He does get to his feet, but he's still over top and has hands on. This should be a penalty against green 20 for not releasing. If we have to manage these parts of the breakdown, in most instances we will have slow ball. It is understandable to manage around the goal line or where pick-and-go style of play has slowed the ball already. In this clip, see how the referee manages the defense, but the ball is already slowed.
Release tackler. You're holding.
A penalty kick against the white defender would be a good choice there. When the tackle assist player releases and gets hands on the ball with a lift, they should be rewarded with a ball carrier not releasing penalty if they don't win the turnover. Here the referee correctly awarded the ball to black by giving the ball carrier not releasing penalty. The referee can allow this situation to develop some in 15s, as we don't necessarily expect lightning quick ball at a turnover. Once the referee has ensured that the tackler and the tackle assist are clear, we can turn our attention to the actions of the ball carrier. Ideally, the ball carrier should make the ball available to be played immediately. Recently, we have seen ball carriers making self-generated movements to avoid the jackler. This can be a roll or a crawl along the ground. Much like at the end goal line, we need to understand the difference between momentum and an extra movement. Here, black 15 rolls forward, taking out the legs of the arriving players and changing the gate. White is unable to compete for the ball, and the quality of the contest is impacted. This is an easy penalty kick to give against the black ball carrier for the extra movement. Sometimes the extra movement can be immaterial. In this clip, we see the blue player make a very clear self-generated roll. But as there is no defense in the area to play the ball, it is not material, and we should play on. Finally, if no tackler is in the zone, the ball carrier should release the ball to an arriving defensive player, if they're on their feet. Here we see the referee allow the play to develop, as the defense wins the ball from the breakdown. In 15s, we do want to allow a contest at the breakdown, and a quick penalty for the ball carrier not releasing is not needed here. The team in blue wins the turnover in a reasonable time frame. The first arriving defensive player at the breakdown can set up for a ruck or play the ball. If they play the ball, they're known as a jackler. The jackler must beat the ruck and be the first arriving player. If they are first arriver, they can have one go at the pickup. Here the player picks up the ball after the ruck is formed. The penalty is correctly awarded. The jackler must be able to support their body weight and stay on their feet. In this next clip, the Harlequins 8 enters the tackle zone with good body position, has hands on the ball, and lifts. The ball carrier prevents him from making a good poach, and he then loses his feet. The penalty should have been awarded to the Quins for ball carrier not releasing. The jackler must have two hands on the ball and lift. Here we see the jackler gets overextended and cannot support his own body weight. The advantage is correctly given to the attack. If they came back, the penalty would be awarded for white off feet. Here we see the blue jackler get overextended, and his hands go beyond the ball. If he was able to reload before contact, he might be immaterial, but here he scoops for the ball, and white gets the penalty for blue off feet. A jackler with hands beyond ball prevents a fair contest. Finally, the jackler can be rolled out of a ruck, but we cannot pull players through the ruck. In this clip, the red jackler is in a strong position to secure the turnover. Then he's pulled through the ruck by the black player. A jackler can be rolled out, but no player can be pulled through a ruck. So, to summarize all of that, our philosophy is to hold the defense to a high standard. The defense must do everything right to get the holding on call. The tackler must be out of the tackle zone. The poacher must use the gate, show a clear release if they were the tackle assist player, support their body weight, and be able to lift the ball with two hands. If these conditions are met, the referee should reward a jackler who does not get clean ball with a holding on penalty against the ball carrier. In this first clip, the red tackler pops to her feet, but always keeps hands on the ground over the ball carrier. As she never fully releases, she can't poach the ball. The referee correctly awards the penalty for tackler not releasing. Here, White 7 is going to be the tackler. She rides the ball carrier to the ground. There is no clear release. We cannot reward the jackal. The correct call here would be tackler assist not releasing. In this final clip, the gold jackaling players appear to do everything right and are in a position of strength. But we cannot reward them because the gold tackler is still in the tackle zone and on the wrong side of the ball. She impacts the red arrival to the breakdown and therefore the quality of the contest. The correct penalty should be for tackler not rolling away. The next thing referees need to look at when officiating the breakdown is arriving players. Arriving players must keep their feet. In each of these next videos, we can see how players off their feet, diving or sealing, impacts the quality of the contest. Sealing on attack is material. The attack should not be allowed to maintain possession by preventing the contest. One latching player is permitted. The latching player must support their own weight and not seal at the breakdown. Referees should position themselves at the ruck at the 45-degree angle so they can identify players who do not enter through the gate. both of those penalties were clearly and obviously side entry, and the referees did a very good job calling. The next thing is the referees should position themselves so they can manage the pillars into an onside position. Pillars who are positioning themselves in front of the ruck and not fully bound should be managed onside. Referees must remain vigilant for takeouts beyond the tackle ruck. This usually happens 1 meter from the breakdown, and if we're watching the ball, it's easy to miss. Players must not tackle players who are not part of the ruck, and you cannot hold players who aren't part of the ruck tackle area. Thanks for watching this module for the WPL 2022 guidelines on our key priorities at the breakdown. If you have questions or comments, please contact me, Amanda Cox, at amanda.referee@gmail.com. Thanks.